Today, we're going to look at Egyptian fractions. And by that, I do mean the ancient Egyptians. They worked base 10, like we do. So they had symbols. And I'm going to attempt to draw some hieroglyphs. So their symbol for the number one is this. Groundbreaking. It's called a single stroke. So if they wanted to say two, they combine two of these. For 10 in hieroglyphs, they have this, which I believe is called a cattle hobble, which I think was used, you maybe put it around cattle's legs to slow them down. I looked into it, don't really know what that does, but this is a 10, which is a far more interesting use of it. For 100, and now I'm almost definitely going to get this the wrong way around, but I think it's this way, and it's a coil of rope. I'm pretty sure it's that way around. Someone will correct me if it's not. For 1000, this is when it gets slightly more complicated, and I've got to use my art GCSE. It is the water lily. For 10,000, a bent finger. That looks vaguely like this. And that's a bent finger, okay? Bent finger. 100,000, obviously, whenever I think of 100,000, what I think of is tadpoles. So this is a tadpole. And now finally, a million, and this really is going to be putting my art skills to use. A million is hair. Now hair is the personification of eternity or infinity. So a million also kind of just means an eternal or infinite amount, which isn't actually unheard of in cultures that we have things like this. Some people believe that 1001 Arabian Nights actually is meant to mean infinity in a bit more. So the idea of there being a very large number, meaning that number or infinity, is actually not an uncommon idea at all. So these are the Egyptian hieroglyphs for powers of 10. And if you wanted to, maybe say you wanted to write, I don't know, 23, what you'd do is you would write two tens and a three, and you just combine them like that. So now on to fractions. I'm going to be talking about, I'm getting technical here, earlier Egyptian fractions. So there is actually evidence that fractions were done slightly different later on. There's a famous papyrus called the Rhind Mathematical Papyrus. What we're going to be talking about is earlier, when fractions were all done by having a mouth symbol like this, and then a number underneath. So you might say this, and what this would be is a tenth, because it's the mouth symbol over 10. Now, with this, we can only get numbers, fractions with one in the numerator. In fact, there are only two exceptions to this. So we can have 2/3, which is like this, and then there is also 3/4, and a half, for some reason, is different. But aside from that, all others are of the form 1/n. So it begs the question, how is this useful? What happens if we have another fraction? What happens if we have, say, 5/6? Well, 5/6 is going to be just a half plus a third. So actually, we can still do this. Now, with Egyptian fractions, which is what these are called, all the denominators have to be different. Should we try another one? 15/36 is going to be a third, is 12/36, and that leaves 3/36. Which is equal to a 12. So far, looks like we can do it. The question is, can we always do it? So for this, I want to introduce you to the greedy algorithm. We've got our fraction p over q, and we're gonna say p is not one, because we know if p is one, we can do it. We'll just write it as is. And the greedy algorithm looks at the largest 1/n, such that 1/n is less than p over q. And we start by just taking away this 1/n. What do we know about this? This is going to be positive because we know this is less than this. So we'll end up with pn minus q over qn, which is positive. Okay. We can actually write an expression for n as well. We could write n is the ceiling function of q over p. So it means it's the smallest integer above this fraction. Ah, we haven't actually used the fact that 1/n is the greatest for which this is true. Because what this means is that p over q is also going to be less than 1/n-1. So we've said that this is going to be the smallest such n, or the largest such 1/n, they're the same thing, that's less than this. Hence, we have this inequality too. Now from this, we can multiply this out. And then we get that, for example, p times n-1 is less than q. Now if we substitute this in, we get that pn minus q is strictly less than p. And we already know it's positive, remember. So we've started with p over q, we've taken away 1 over n, and now we've ended up with a new fraction. We'll call it p1 over q1, such that p1 is less than p. Now, if p1 is 1, we're done, because then we could just say that p over q is 1 over n plus p1 over q1. And if p1 is 1, we're done. If not, we just repeat this process. So we can then say that, okay, let's find the largest such 1 over n, the smallest n, that we get p1 over q1. It's greater than 1 over, let's call it n1, and less than this. And we just repeat. And then we'll end up with p1 over q1 take 1 over n1 equals p2 over q2. And again, we'll have, okay, that 0 is less than p2 is less than p1. And we can substitute back in, get p over q is 1 over n plus 1 over n1. Plus then this will be p2 over q2. And again, if p2 is 1, we're done. If not, we repeat it again. So this is why it's called an algorithm. It's a series of steps. And what we're going to end up having is 0 is less than pr for some r is less than, and it just keeps going, less than p. But these are all integers. These are all positive numbers. We can't have it going down infinitely. One of these is eventually, we're going to have to hit 1. And the way we've constructed these q's, they're all going to be different as well. Hence, this process is eventually going to terminate. But yeah, eventually we're going to get a pr that equals 1. So we're going to have p over q is 1 over n plus 1 over n1 plus 1 over then qr, and we're going to be done. So eventually this process does stop. So this greedy algorithm means that there is always an Egyptian fraction. Okay, there is one final cool thing that I want to share with you. Because here, you remember, we used a greedy algorithm where we took the biggest 1 over n, so n was this value. Now if we slightly change this, if we slightly cheat, and instead use that n is q over p plus 1. And I'm going to show you this for 1. So 1 equals, well, here, q over p, it's 1 over 1. So q over p is going to be 1 plus 1 is 2. So that's a half. And then what we're going to do with our half, this is our new p over q. So q over p, 2 over 1 is 2. 2 over 1 plus 1 is 3. So it's a half plus a third. What remains is a sixth. And we can keep following this algorithm. We get a half plus a third plus, it'd be a seventh plus 1 over 43 plus and so on. This is the cool thing as well. Because here, if at any point we truncate it, it gives the Egyptian fraction closest to 1 for that many terms. So a half is the Egyptian fraction with one term closest to 1. A half plus a third is the Egyptian fraction with two terms closest to 1. A half plus a third plus a seventh is the Egyptian fraction with three terms closest to 1. And I just think it's really cool.
I love that there are so many courses on Brilliant and always new ones being added. Look here, I've spotted this recent edition on vectors. So, well, I thought I'd check it out. In typical fashion, it's quirky, well-designed, and super interactive. I'm not just watching, I'm doing. All the courses, the quizzes, the content on Brilliant is just like this. It's a great place to learn. It doesn't feel like education, it feels like fun. But I'm learning at the same time. If you haven't already, you might want to consider signing up and getting into all this good stuff. Or perhaps give the gift of Brilliant by signing up family and friends for the premium subscription. What a great and unexpected present. Wherever they are on their learning journey, Brilliant has something for everyone. Math, science, computers, it's all covered. Now Brilliant has a free 30-day trial, so you can go and give it a good go. And Numberphile viewers can get a 20% discount on their subscription by going to brilliant.org/numberphile. That URL is there on the screen, and I'll also put a link in the video description. Our thanks to Brilliant for supporting Numberphile.
So my favorite number changes a lot, but for now it is 288. You might be looking at that and thinking, what's special about 288? Don't worry, we'll get there. But first we need to rewind a bit and talk a bit about factorials, specifically superfactorials. Now, I know regular Numberphile viewers will have seen factorials before,